the strictest marketing sense, I think we'd have to admit that they're used to promote records. But I always preferred to see them as short films, and actually made them before there was MTV or anything like that. I would advise artists to be as involved in your video as you can be, or you're going to look like a putz up there, because somebody else is going to get involved that doesn't care as much as you. But yeah, I like good actors. If we must have actors, let's have really good ones. Well, I've been lucky to have some pretty good ones, you know, Faye Dunaway and Johnny Depp and Kim Basinger, all at least, you know. I'm very fortunate, really, to be able to get these people, but it sure made the videos better. Best friends with Mary Jane, one more time to kill the pain. I feel something creeping in and I'm tired of this town again.
Now, I'd like to tell you the story of Eddie and his adventures in the great wide open.
Into the Great Wide Open will always just be my favorite one we ever did. It's just a ball. But there you had a narrative song. The great sin to me in a video is spelling out the song, right? Going by the lyrics. But there I went exactly by the lyrics because it was a story. So it was an exception to the rule, but it worked very well.
He met a girl out there with the tattoo too. The future was wide open.
I love that video in particular because on the set, because we were shooting on the streets of Hollywood and in the clubs, and you really couldn't tell where reality, you know, began and ended. You couldn't tell who was an extra and who wasn't. You know, that scene where we're on the road with all those bikers on Hollywood Boulevard, I had no idea who was supposed to be there and who wasn't. I thought it was a very successful video because it really captured all those. I love throwing MTV awards at him in the pool, and it's so realistic.
Video Vanguard Award goes to Tom Petty.
It wasn't until last year when I got that award that I really realized how many we'd made. And really, they're pretty good when I see them back, the little film clips and stuff. I'm kind of proud of our videos. I think that they're pretty good. So I enjoy making films, and I've learned all about it over the years, and I always enjoyed being on the set and seeing what lens and how you light this and how you make this happen, and it's tremendously interesting to me. The idea there was to have no cuts, which is very against the grain. There's no cut in it. It's just one shot. There's no editing. And the hardest thing was ignoring the gunshots going off and that damn bank thing falling. I had a little chalk mark. If I got behind that chalk mark, I was going to be toast. Yeah,
you ask me, you guys are a long way off. My choice for handsomest man has got to be Mr. Tom Petty.
Tom Petty, the rock star? Excuse me, Paul, but he is a really gawky-looking guy.
Now, you couldn't be more wrong, Joe. Every time I look into that fabulous face, I can sense his deep feelings and emotions that go into his words and music. He's quite an attractive man. And I'd be willing to fight any guy who doesn't think so.
My whole idea of the Heartbreakers when it started was to have a group that mixed kind of the Byrds and the Rolling Stones. Was to have like the Byrds with a harder rock R&B sensibility, but also somewhat poetic and folky.
As always, I'm Tom Petty. These are the Heartbreakers.
Mike Campbell is probably, you know, one of the better guitar players around, and I think that I wouldn't be here giving the interview if I wasn't with Mike Campbell, because he's just such a great player, and he always has been one of those really natural guitarists, and a great songwriter and a great producer, as it turned out. Well, Ben Montinch can really play any song there is.
Viva Las Vegas.
We play this game called Stump Ben, where you really can't call out anything he doesn't know. he's kind of an oddity. He can play anything.
Viva Las Vegas, where the lights are flashing and the neon signs are crashing and
Ben plays so effortlessly that I wonder if it's not a problem for him at times, because there's really no effort in what he does. It's just deciding what to do. But a tremendous talent, tremendously talented fellow. So that was always the core of the Heartbreakers, was me, Mike, and Ben, who have played together since 1970. And then Stan Lynch was our drummer until this year, for 20 years. Terrific drummer, very funny guy. If you stand in the room, you're going to know it. And our first bass player was a fellow we knew from Gainesville, and Ron Blair, who had a very good tone on the bass. He left us early on in 1982. So Howie Epstein came in there, who was a great find. I found him in Del Shannon's band. And Howie is a great bass player, a great guitarist, but what I really count on him most for is his high harmony, because he has a really nice high voice and really great harmony singing. I don't know if people really see us as a harmony group, but we sure do work on it really hard, you know. We work on singing a lot. Don't have much conflict of egos. We have had, you know, but we've kind of grown out of that stage where we really do all feel that we're there for the same purpose, and that's to make a good record.
All right, well, we're going to have to get out on a little tour of Gainesville and get home tomorrow night, because Billy Squire is going to be dancing on TV later. A little later on, I'm going to be applying for a driver's license, so I want y'all to stick around. Well,
John, what the f*** are you doing?
I just want to go through here for a second. Whoops, speed bump.
What the f*** you doing?
I want to let the car cool just a little bit. It seems like the fan belt's real bad on this thing. This isn't my car. Yeah, we're having a lot of fun now.
The way they can probably was a very, probably summed up a lot of the 80s for us. I I see the 80s like in a little different way, because there was the early 80s, which was still kind of the leftover punk and new wave vibe for a while. And then the mid-80s was a period of great confusion for a long, it was for us, in a way, because we had to find some other ground. By that point, we felt like we have really mined this field, you know? We've worked this style of music to death, and we're not going to remain interested if we don't get somewhere else. And I think it was probably Southern Accents where I really started to find some other ground and another way to work. My favorite record that we made in the 80s was probably Don't Come Around Here No More, that I thought as a single really worked and was, it didn't sound like anything I'd ever heard before. I actually liked that album a lot. And doing Southern Accents kind of gave us a new kind of confidence that I don't think we had a year earlier.
Don't come around here no more. Don't come around here no more. Whatever you're looking for.
From there on, a lot of stuff happened to us in the late 80s, where that was where Dylan came into our life, and we spent 2 years playing with Bob.
Tom and Jeff and I had written a couple of songs together, and I always wanted to write with Bob and George. And I think we did it for the music's sake, you know. We did it for music.
I was known for the one who was just unashamed, you know, to shout out anything. And I would just shout out whatever came to my head, and which really wouldn't have been part of my personality before that. But I think in that group of people were sung, that was a very interesting kind of songwriting experience where you had four, sometimes five people all writing the same song.
You loved your public curtains. You loved your power steering. You loved your bottle of water. You loved your parts and service.
We were just having fun, really. We keep saying that over and over, but it's just because it was true. On one hand, you couldn't believe we were really doing it, that it was coming off so well. And so you didn't want to question it. You just kept doing it.
Does she drive a truck? Does she can drive a train? She can't even drive an airplane. She's so good to look at in the
It makes you feel good, I think, simply put, the album does. And that's the nice thing about it, is that all that feeling went onto the tape, which is what you always hope
would
happen.
Okay.
And it's not easy, but it was lucky.
Well, it's all right, even if it's not.
late 87, I started to work on, very late, like say December, I started to work on Full Moon Fever. Jeff Lynne was going to leave for England in a matter of weeks, and I wanted to make the record right then. So that was really how it started.
She's a good girl, loves her mama, loves Jesus, in America too. She's a good girl, is crazy about Elvis, loves horses, and her boyfriend too.
But I really needed to do it, you know. I'd been in a band my whole life, it felt like. And at that point, it'd been, you know, I don't know, 14 or 15 years. And I wanted the freedom. I really wanted to be free of the democratic process. I didn't want to have to ask anybody or have it approved by anybody. So that was kind of how that came about. Went right into the 90s, and then from the 90s, when I looked up after the last album we did was Into the Great Wide Open, and that was me during the Gulf War and all that, you know, which was kind of a downer.
I'm learning to fly, but I ain't got wings. Coming down is a hard.
And then I thought, well, it's time to switch gears again. Because I just worked in this field a long time, really enjoyed it. But I think it was time to just turn the corner and try to find another place to go, and the result was Wildflowers. Mike Campbell came up with these great chords that reminded me of records we used to make, like back. It's just exactly like a Heartbreakers record from the late 70s. A down day, you know, we really enjoyed, we weren't in a hurry, and we really enjoyed what we were doing. It was hard work sometimes, damn hard work sometimes, but it was never unpleasant. We never used the synthesizer or any computers or anything like that. Everything had to be played by hand, and there's a lot of textures in Wildflowers in the sounds of, you know, just the general sound of the record. I've never understood that, why you would want to type up a number and use that sound. It's much more fun to move the microphone around or to bang on something. Even banging on, you know, the mic stand, if you do it right, is a much more interesting sound than bringing it up on a synth. Or I really don't care for that stuff too much. And I think not having a synthesizer led us into orchestration and using full-on orchestra and strings and horn, you know, orchestral horns, because I'd never really done much of that. But I really enjoyed that when Michael came and did the string arrangements. And that was a gas. I really had a ball doing that.
I think it's the best record we've made in a good 10 or 15 years. I really do. I think Tom wrote, and Mike, just a great bunch of songs. They're the kind of songs that I like. Sounds like Tom really wrote from the heart this time and just kind of let it come out.
I tried, as a rule on this album, to not have any second drafts or rewrites whatsoever. I tried to just take all the lyrics just as they came out of my head, you know, because sometimes you'll have a set of lyrics and you work on them, and you may want to change them later, you know, but this time I thought I would stick with my first thoughts.
It feels very human to me. It doesn't feel very thought about. It feels like here's a song about somebody who feels this way, whether it's Tom feels that way or whether he's writing about another character, I don't know. But it feels very, I don't know, honest or real or something.
Silly song, but lots of fun, and I thought it was necessary, really, because some of the subject matter is kind of serious throughout the album, and I thought it'd be nice to have just some moments of sheer nonsense.
Working on this record, Ralph Lauer's, I enjoyed it the most of any of the times we went and be working on records. I liked it the most. I actually think it's one of my favorite records.
It was a lot of fun. We worked with Rick Rubin. And he brought a whole new energy to the album. It was really refreshing.
I really enjoyed working with him. He's a very enthusiastic guy. And sometimes, you know, probably pushed me harder in some ways than I had been pushed in a while to, you know, where I would think, well, yeah, that's good enough. He wouldn't and would push me a little harder. And sometimes he was right.
It was a good experience for me because I like working with Tom when it's spontaneous and you just kind of sit and play the song and play what comes to mind and find the best interpretation. So this album, we took advantage of the fact that we've been together for a long time and we can play things off the top of our heads.
Here comes that
funny how you'll work all that time to make it sound like you did it in an afternoon was the goal. But I really enjoyed the whole process. I was much closer to this album than a lot of them I've made, I think. I got very close to it and wasn't in any hurry to finish it, really. The hell, I mean, I even get people coming out of comas to songs and thanking me for saving their life. You know, I didn't really save their life, you know, but the song did.
This weekend, VH1 gets out of the studio and into the snow. VH1's Lift Ticket to Ride, 2 days of music and moguls from the slopes of Breckenridge, Colorado, featuring celebrity skiers Ace of Base, Babyface, Gin Blossoms, and Seal, and special Alpine editions of the top 10 and the number ones. VH1's Lift Ticket to Ride, take a snow day. Next Saturday at 2 and Sunday at 12:30, only on VH1.
The music.
Among the wild flowers.
guy. That's kind of what I admired in musicians. My favorite ones were the ones that I kind of believed in, and I felt that they weren't really trying to pull anything over on me. I think it's very embarrassing for 45-year-old men to behave like teenagers and dress like them and pretend to be them. I think that would be a really ugly job to have. But we've been pretty, you know, we're fairly honest dudes, you know? And I don't think we're, you know, particularly any more virtuous than anyone else, but I think that's, we do seem to have the respect of the young people, which I'm very grateful for and very flattered by. And I hope that it's probably because they sense that we're not pandering to them. Wrote something that really helped someone through, that's probably, you know, the greatest reward for doing this that you could have, because I know a lot of music certainly helped me through my life. That's the truly magical thing about music, is that it does have the power to heal and inspire. Fairly often I'll receive a letter from someone who will tell me what this or that song has done for them and how it's helped them overcome this or that. Hell, I mean, I even get people coming out of comas to songs and thanking me for saving their life. You know, I didn't really save their life, you know, but the song did. And if it did, I mean, that's just wonderful. I've been through those downright dark periods, but it's always just believing that there is something redeeming about human beings. That's what carries me through, you know, the toughest times. So I guess it seeps into my work.
Stick around. Tom Petty takes the stage in the live concert film Take the Highway, next on VH1.
Because it's wake up time.